Hi, everyone. Happy Friday to all of you. This is Natalie with My Social Practice, and I am very excited, and My Social Practice is excited to be presenting with Dental Symphony today. We will be talking about preparing patients for COVID-19 protocols, social media, and online forms. Everyone today is on mute, and we'll stay on mute for the webinar, but you can ask questions or make comments in the chat or Q&A features here on Zoom, and that's just at the bottom of your screen. So you'll see a chat bubble and then a Q&A, so feel free to ask questions to our presenters, and we'll answer those questions in the last 10 or so minutes of the webinar. Today, we are very lucky to have two incredible experts presenting. First, we have Dr. Tom Cockrell. He is a 1979 graduate of the dental school at the University of Texas Health Science Center at San Antonio. He also earned his master's degree at Texas Christian University. Since 1980, Dr. Cockrell has conducted a practice in Fort Worth, Texas, with a particular focus on patients with special needs. Dr. Cockrell is the primary designer of Dental Symphony. His experience dealing with the medically compromised and challenging patient led to his conception and development of Dental Symphony. He also assembled and convened the clinical team and serves as its moderator. Dr. Cockrell is a member of the American Dental Association, the Texas Dental Association, and the Fort Worth District Dental Society. We also have Blake Hadley presenting today. Blake is a founder and president of My Social Practice. He has won a number of national and international awards in art direction, advertising, and creative marketing strategy. He is passionate about helping dental practices use out-of-the-box thinking to create stories that spread on social media. Over the past 10 plus years at My Social Practice, he has spoken to dental audiences all over the country and has helped thousands of practices thrive on social media. I am very excited for our listeners to learn from you both about how to communicate with patients using the power of social media and online forums to make their appointments hassle-free. And with that, we'll go ahead and give the time to you, Dr. Cockrell.
Great. Natalie, thank you. Good morning. Blake, good morning. And everyone else, good morning. Thank you for attending today. Certainly my pleasure to get to visit with everyone. I'm looking forward to talking to you and hope that you find my presentation interesting. I'm going to do three things this morning. I wanted to share some of my experience coming back into the office opening after the shutdown. I've been open 3 weeks now. I've learned some things, and so I want to share that, and I hope that would be helpful. I know some places around the country are not open. Some have been open for a few weeks, and then others are preparing or not sure when they're going to open, but it has been a real learning experience. I appreciate an opportunity to share some of my experiences. I certainly want to talk about online forms and teledentistry. Very helpful to where we are now. So, you know, it's kind of Boy Scout like, you know, you got to be prepared. So before I reopened the office, I prepared myself as best I could. And then you had to prepare your office, prepare your staff. And then what we'll be focusing on today is preparing patients for their experience. So for myself, you know, this began for all of us weeks ago, before the shutdown. You know, when we started hearing about this virus, and so I read about it, I attended webinars, and I talked to colleagues about what to do to get ready to come back. And I advise that don't go through this by yourself. Find a friend, find a colleague, talk over what you're doing, what your friend would think needs to be done. Talk to their staff and your staff, and just get ready. It takes some time to get a handle and a grasp on all that. So that's what I did before I opened. And then, excuse me, there are some things to do in the office. And probably most of you are already aware of this and already doing this and getting ready for your opening. You've got to order your PPE, materials. I put air purifiers in all of my operatories and my front desk and in my lab because I read about those, and it seemed to make a lot of sense to me that there would be an instrument that would clear the air in just a few minutes in an operatory. When you read about this virus and you realize that aerosols are less than 5 microns, and so you've got them, you know, floating around in the operatory, it just made a lot of sense to me to put air purifiers in the rooms. And I think it made my staff feel a lot better. So that's one of the things I did in preparing my office. You might want to consider removing chairs in your reception room. We did that. Because we don't want a lot of people hanging around in the reception room at all, put a ladder barrier in front of my front desk person that visit with people. And then I put signs on the front door to keep people from just walking in without masks and things. So there are some things to do to prepare your office. And then to prepare the staff, that's really important. You know, you're the expert. Staff depends upon you and upon me and us to take care of them and inform them. So I imagine you've been talking to your staff for a long time before this point to help get them ready. And we did that in staff meetings. I gave them literature to read, and I expected them to read it, and we would talk about it afterwards. And then the main thing, I wanted them to be thinking about aerosols and thinking about contaminated surfaces and just washing their hands and wiping things down all the time. I had them watch webinars, and we practiced before I opened. We came in the day before and spent about a half a day going through all of our PPE gear and practicing garbing and gowning and then degowning. And when you finish a procedure, what comes off first and then what comes on, what goes on first, what comes off first. I mean, it's surprisingly complicated. There's a lot to think about and you're kind of nervous. It really helps to practice. I mean, it's really helpful. I also hired another assistant that I call my PPE officer, and that person's job is to help organize the use of PPE, the reception of patients, and to watch what happens and to help the staff. I don't have a real big office. I have a couple of hygienists, a couple of assistants, and two front desk people. So it's not that there's this lot of people, but it gets down to a single person and what is that person doing and how much protection are they what policies are they following for protection? It's easy to get confused. And so it's been a really helpful thing in my office to have someone that's designated to meet the patient at the door, take their temperature, have them fill out a form, escort that person into the operatory where the assistant is, make sure the assistant gets gowned. I mean, that to me, that just made all the difference in the world. So I'm just telling you my experiences. You've got to talk to your staff about policies that you do expect them to follow, your policies on barriers, and remind them that offsite activities, you know, they can't willy-nilly go do anything they want just because they're not out to your office. They cannot bring the COVID virus in because they are not following safe protocol. You've got to tell them that, and they have to understand that for some time they have to be really careful. You have a healthcare facility and you would expect that to be safe at all times. So then let's talk about the focus of today, preparing patients. It's really important. You want patients to come back. They're a little nervous about it. Some of them aren't. The first thing that I did was I created a video and sent it to my patients. And I just did it right in here in my office. I use an application called Loom.com. You can go to it and just made a video. It was about 10 minutes and I just talked to my patients. And we sent it to all of them, and I use Mojo to distribute it to the patients. And for every time a patient is confirmed, that link to that video is sent to them. And I get a lot of compliments about that and appreciation that patients when they've seen that. And essentially I'm just talking to the patients and I'm just welcoming them back. And I meant it, glad to see them. I talked to them about the PPE barriers that we would be wearing and about what would happen when they would come to the office. We're gonna take their temperature. appointments might be longer. I'm going to be in there with them a little bit longer than, or not necessarily longer, but more, less in and out. And to get used to that, I showed them what it would look like all masked up and with a shield and took it off and said, this is who I am. This is what I look like. You know me. I know you. I just tried to reassure them and encourage them to come back. And I want to talk now about online forms as part of that. This is just where I sit during the day, and I got these lights. I mean, if you're going to be doing videos, if you're going to be using teledentistry, then you've got to have good lighting. These two lights that I saw that you see here, I got from Amazon. And I think they're like $100, and they're to go on stands, but I modified them so they would sit in front of me and give good lighting for that. And that's going to be important. So just kind of a tip there. Online forms, focus of the day, really important. I think it's more important now. We offer them through Dental Symphony. There are lots of advantages. They save time. They make you paperless and another kind of a new word, contactless. You do not want your staff, I don't think anyway, handling paper, handling pens, people sitting in your reception room, filling things out and giving them to you on clipboards. It's just kind of, we want to get away from that, at least for the time being, maybe for the indefinite future. A good online system will collect a thorough medical history with drug histories. Drug descriptions is what I mean to say. A good system will also allow you to have customized forms for if you have any particular specialty interests or special interests. They're not expensive at all, and they just save you a lot of time and money. It modernizes your office. It's a good thing to use. So what do they look like? How do they work? You can have your staff send a patient a link to a portal, or you can just put them on your website, and that's what we do. So your patients will see these, and then they'll click on the link, and in our solution, the first thing they see are your office policies, which is really neat. You can put in everything you've ever wanted to tell a patient before they come in. What you expect from them. And they're as you see, there are check boxes here where they promise that what they're going to tell you is the truth, and you can have others all customizable. You put a place for them to check that they've seen the HIPAA notice and that they are whom they say they are, and the information they're giving you is is accurate. And then a place to collect a signature is provided. So that's what patients see. Now, what does an office see? Our solution has, I guess it's pretty common, it's a notification list so that the people at your front desk, this comes up and they can see that, for instance, these are three patients and they're designated as new. They might also say update, but you can view the forms that the patients have submitted so far to see how far they're coming along. If you need to nudge them because they've sort of stalled out or something, and we need to get that dental history form or insurance information or something, so you can nudge them. It'll send an email to please finish, and then you can then print the information, paste it into your practice management system, or we integrate into some. I wanted you to, so that's what the front desk sees. And so, you know, no patient contact at all. It's really for the patients, really for the front desk. This is what we provide. And of course we do provide a gross output of the form where you see the checks that the patients have put on forms, but we do an analysis, a summary. And all of this is designed to save time and help move patients into the chair, and you can treat them very quickly. We provide a summary output of the patient's medical history, and you can see by looking here that this patient had indicated they have diabetes. Well, we provide a solution for follow-up questions so that you get more information. And it's the kind of information that you're going to want to have before you actually move the patient into care. And also some alerts, like we'll pick up things like if the patient has checked, has selected an asthma drug, but they didn't check that they had any asthma or lung problems, well, then you're given a note so that that's what the patient sees. That's what the staff sees. So let's talk about how to make this online form kind of a special experience for the patients. And we like this solution of sending a welcome packet back to the patient as soon as they register. And so our information that's sent back to the patient will have things like the listing of their chief complaints, which is a good thing because patients then see that you're listening. Everybody hates filling out forms. It doesn't matter what it's for. Who wants to do it? It's nice to get something back that shows that you've been listening. Also, it helps build that relationship because it's a difficult time now, isn't it? To build relationships, you meet new people and you're dressed up like you're an astronaut or the mummy. So anything that you can do to take advantage of the fact that the patient has registered online and then get back to them with some information that says that you're excited to see them, how can that not be just a great thing? It's very helpful. So this is what a new patient welcome packet presentation looks like. I mean, it just, and they're viewing this online. They're just scrolling through it on their iPad or computer or whatever. It's kind of like a PowerPoint presentation, but a lot nicer looking. And it's just as a welcome letter. You know, thank you for using the system. Looking forward to seeing you. You can customize this and put whatever you want to. This is a page that pulls out from the dental history the things that the patient has said they're looking for. So obviously this is just a sample patient, but isn't it nice for the patient to see this and realize, oh wow, they're going to help me with the things that I'm want to see them about. It's a nice thing. You can also include videos. This is provided for us by a movie web. You can, it's a real nice video that provides information about your COVID protocols, the reason we're talking today. It's a beautiful movie and it talks about everything about wearing a mask, the hand hygiene, and you're going to take their temperature. Don't bring your friends. You're not going to be able to sit in our reception room for a while. It just orients them to what's happening so that there'll be no surprises. So let's talk about teledentistry as part of your protocols. This is something that I might have been a little skeptical about, but I have found it's very helpful. I sit in this place again and I visit with patients using a program that they see me and I see them, and it works amazingly well. I'm just was really surprised at how well it works. I use it for consultations, new patients. Sometimes they want to meet busy a computer. I do for follow-up. And are there other uses? Yes. I mean, I don't see this going away because it's very helpful. I just think that you ought to look into it and figure out a way to make it helpful for your office. Now, they're quick. I mean, you can get to the point quickly when you're doing it. They're effective. Patients like them, and I like them. And believe it or not, patients will put their phone right up to their mouth, and you can see things. And it's you can make nice recommendations. You know, how many times have we seen patients in the chair? And you realize, well, they didn't really need to be there. I could have handled this by the phone, or it's been a waste of time. Teledentistry for evaluation of patients ahead of time, I believe is going to grow in importance. I find it very useful. So, kind of like the new patient welcome, how do you make something beyond just a registration system? How do you make teledentistry more than just a fancy phone call? Our solution has a form on the portal that the patients can complete that is a request for teledentistry, online consultation, virtual consultation, whatever you want to call it. It's a request for that, and it has them give you some information that specifies why they're calling, and that's important because you can save time. Have the appropriate people on the call. It's just very helpful. It also gives a consent. The patient has to sign a consent for the consultation. It tells them what the fee is going, that there could be a fee, And we can draw all that information and provide a report back to the patient, just like the new patient welcome presentation. Let me show you what that looks like. This is a portal, and you see I have circled here that this is kind of related topic. It's a coronavirus questionnaire you want to ask all your patients that. Let me move on to, actually, this would be, it's kind of hard to see here, but this is the online consultation request. Because I clicked it, it's kind of grayed out. But this is where the patient puts in the information about why they want to see you and what the problems are, what they want to get accomplished, sign the consent, who's going to be on the consultations. So they submit that just like any other form. And so this is what a report would look like. You see, you may recognize it's kind of like the new patient welcome packet. So this consultation report is sent right back to the patient via their portal. It's secure, HIPAA, encrypted, very fine. So here you see then the report of the consultation, and the top part comes from the form that they completed. You know, I have a broken tooth and I'm afraid and my mother will be attending the consultation. This is the part where you give your recommendation, and it follows the SOAP, subjective, objective assessment and plan. It follows that system. And then if you prescribe medications, and then what to do afterwards. And you can add to it videos if you want. For instance, the patient has a broken tooth and you're looking at it and talking to them and you think they're going to need a crown, then it's nice. Would you send something back to them? They can see what that's all about. Or if are complaining of pain, you think they may need a root canal, then you can put any number of videos on your report back to the patient to give some substance to that teledentistry consultation. So I'm nearing the end of my presentation. Blake, I wanted to show this just kind of as a tip. It's unrelated to anything, but I thought it was so important. And that is when you're wearing these masks, it's sometimes or all the time, the air will come up and make everything foggy and it's hard to see. So someone gave me a tip of taking one of these N95 masks and putting a little impression material and then adapting it to your face and letting it set. It will stick onto the mask. Oh my gosh, what a difference that made. So just a tip, I hope that might be helpful. I hope that the other information that I provided this morning about protocols for welcoming your patients back and the use of online forms and these kinds of digital technologies, I hope that's helpful. So I wanna thank you. You could contact us if you're interested in the e-patient registration system, or if you're interested in the new patient welcome or the online consultation report, then you would inquire about our suite. So I want to say thank you for listening. And Blake and Natalie, I would be happy to take questions and then listen in, Blake, to all the good things that you're going to tell us.
Great. Thanks so much, Tom. Appreciate that. We'll probably take the questions. I see there's a few questions that have come in. I think we're going to cover all the questions just in the last 10 minutes of this webinar. So hang tight if you've asked a question, and we'll cover that at the end. All right, thanks so much, Tom. Let me switch screens here. And let me just turn to my screen. All right. Hopefully all of you can see this okay. I wanted to put this comic up here before I start my presentation because it applies to what Tom talked about. This is maybe a morning huddle of a dental practice or a business in a conference room. And the leader here says, digital transformation is years away. I don't see her company having to change anytime soon. And then there's this giant COVID-19 wrecking ball headed their way. And excuse me. I think that this applies so much to dental practices and so much to the things that Tom was talking about, because, you know, even thinking about just online forms, maybe that was something you never thought of before, or you thought maybe we should probably do this sometime, but I don't think we have to do it anytime soon. Who would have ever thought that, you know, a patient coming into your office using a pen and paper would be potentially a safety hazard, right? That someone might be uncomfortable doing. This is why a digital transformation of what you're doing and putting online forms on your website is so important right now. And so if there's any time to think about this, it's now, while you maybe have some time, maybe you're in quarantine still. Try to get your office as digitally transformed as possible. All right, so my presentation is specifically on social media marketing. If you know my social practice, we are a social media marketing agency that's helped thousands of practices over the years improve their social media presence and really their online presence. So I'm going to talk about how using social media is effective in communicating these new safety protocols before you open your practice and after you open your practice. So my social practice has developed a five-phase process for you to open your practice. And we want you to focus on specific things in your social media as you open it. So the first phase is this access and availability phase. And this is something that was really important while you're in quarantine, to make sure that everything, that you're on a number of different platforms and that you're available to your patients. We then moved into a relationships and reputation phase. This was, again, during quarantine. We encouraged our practices not to necessarily focus on marketing at this time, but more about maintaining relationships and building your reputation in your community. The next phase is the safety and scheduling phase. And this is the phase that I'm going to focus on today. This is making sure you're communicating your new safety protocols and your scheduling plan. How are you planning to schedule your patients after all this, or right before you open? The next is the expertise and empathy phase, which is just showing that you are a professional, that you're prepared, that you're buttoned down, and you're ready to open your practice. And also showing empathy, as many people are have anxiety and having financial burdens right now. How can you show empathy in your practice to your patients? And then the last is the convenience and consistency phase. And this is the phase that will take your digital presence into this new normal that everybody keeps talking about. How can you be prepared for the future? And how can you meet the expectations that are now being set by patients in your practice? So that this is the five-phase process. So you can download this worksheet and get started at whatever phase you're in right now. If you go to info.mysocialpractice.com/worksheet, you can download this for free. We're offering it to everybody. If you just go to mysocialpractice.com, there's a green bar at the top. That's all of our COVID resources. You can go to that and download a bunch of stuff that we're providing as well. You know, I'm going to actually stop my screen share because I have a bunch of videos that I want to show, and I didn't click on something. So give me one second here. Stop share. Let me just jump right back here. I just need to make sure I click one thing here. Okay, sorry about that. Okay, we should be good. Hopefully everybody can see the screen again. All right, so I am, like I mentioned, I'm gonna be focusing on the safety and scheduling phase. And you, as you can see, this is right before you open. This is probably the phase that most of you are in right now. Maybe some of you have opened, like Dr. Cockerell has opened, but you can still focus on this phase even if you've opened already. So this is maybe how you might be feeling right now. This is actually a photo I saw online. It was a meme that was just kind of poking fun a little bit of all the different safety protocols that you have to put in place in your office. And you probably feel like this is you now, and this is what is expected of you before every patient. Can you imagine the prep work it would take to do that in your office? But you have a lot that you're trying to prepare for. But the reality of it is, this is how your patients might be feeling right now. There is a lot of anxiety about going out into the world right now, and especially to the dentist. I think if someone was anxious about going to the dentist in the past, they're even maybe more anxious about going to the dentist now, as someone's going to be working in their mouth and they're really unsure about what's happening. So I want to show you some ways that you can ease some of this fear and some of this anxiety that your patients are feeling right now. So sometimes we get this question at my social practice about kind of everything that we do. And the question is, if patients are concerned about something at this, you know, right now it would be about maybe your safety protocols, why don't they just pick up the phone and call us, right? You know, you have Nancy that's sitting at the front desk and she is ready to take phone calls and she's great and she can explain things well. Why don't just patients, if they have a question about this or they're concerned, why don't they just call us, right? And let me give you a few reasons why patients might not call you right now if they're concerned, and why they might check your online presence first before they pick up the phone, and your social media first. So first, they're already there. They found out that during the time of quarantine, I think there was an increase, like a 70% increase in social media usage during quarantine. People were online, they were checking their social media accounts, they were connecting with their friends, they were checking the news. So they're already there. That's where they're spending time, is on social media. So if you're easily accessible on social media, that's a great advantage. Next, it's easier to multitask. As you know, the reason why you maybe text people or use social media is because you can be doing multiple things at once, and you can send a quick message and then you can get back to what you're doing without having to commit time to a phone call. I know that may sound silly, but that's kind of how people are thinking now. There's less pressure, just the pressure of, you know, maybe feeling like they have to talk to somebody, they have to respond quickly, they have to decide on the answer. Maybe, you know, I think I've heard a lot of times, you know, receptionists will ask somebody what their availability is on their schedule, and the person will say, well, I'm available anytime, you know, my schedule's open. And then when you say a time that you have available, they're like, oh, well, actually, I can't do that time. So this gives people time to think a little bit about their schedule, look at their schedule, and then respond when they're ready. One other thing with social media is, I don't know about you, but when I go to post on social media, I actually like to read the comments. And comments are actually really helpful because it shows what other people are concerned about, what other people are asking. And for me, I can see the response from the business about to those comments, and it helps me kind of think, oh, well, I'm glad that person asked that question because I have that same question. So it helps a lot to see and read those comments. And then now, really, updates are expected on your social media accounts. If you don't have a social media presence now, it will really kind of look bad for your company. It's expected that you're updating people and that you're using social media to do that. So in this presentation, I want to show you a number of different video examples. And I'm focusing on video because of, I think, the power of it, especially on social media. And Tom referred to a video that he made about this and talked about how effective that was in sending that to his patients. And you can do video in a number of ways. You can send it through email, you can put it on YouTube, but social media is just a great place to host all these videos. So I want to show you some examples of what practices have done really well in preparing their patients. So this first example is from Frost Orthodontics, and they did a virtual walkthrough of the patient experience. He actually just took his camera. It's not super polished. He just turned his front-facing camera on, and he walked the patient through, or he walked through the practice from the front door as if he were a patient. So let me show you the first part of this video here.
Hey, Frost family, it's Dr. Nichols. We're so excited to see you for your next appointment. We've missed you so much. We wanted to take you through some of the extra precautions that we're taking this week and in coming weeks to ensure the safety of you, your family, and our team. So I'm gonna be the patient. We're gonna walk through the office and let's see what's going on.
All right. Hey, Caitlin, how's it going?
Hi, Ken. How are you, Dr. Nichols?
So awesome. I'm just so excited for my adjustment today.
That's good. We're excited for you to be here. So come on over here. I'm going to have you first use some hand sanitizer.
Okay, I can do that. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Aaron, do you mind checking Dr. Nichols in?
Absolutely. Thanks, Aaron.
Thank you. And then we're going to have you sign this consent form. It asks if you are over 100 degrees, if you have traveled, anything like that. So if you can have that filled out. And while you're doing that, I'm going to check your temperature, if that's okay.
Yep, sounds good to me.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. So that one is just, he just, again, turned his front-facing camera on and just went for it, right? Just walked in the office as if you were a patient, not super polished. And that's a great way to do it. Here's one that's a little more polished. The same idea of a virtual walkthrough, but they've edited a little bit more, but I want to show you this. Show that whole thing, but you get the idea. They take them through the office and they have little captions below to show them what to expect. Here's another one that it's again same idea, but they had a little bit of fun with it, and I think it's okay to have a little bit of fun. This was actually created on TikTok, if you're familiar with what TikTok is, and it's to the theme of the Full House. If you know the show Full House, it's to their intro song. So let me show this.
Whatever happened to predictability? The milkman, the paperboy, evening TV. You miss your old familiar friends waiting just around the bend.
That's a video from our good friends at Dublin Metro Dental. They do a great job at sort of these sort of things. So it's okay to have some fun. You don't have to, everything doesn't have to be super serious if you don't want to go that direction. Another idea for your safety is to show the behind the scenes of cleaning your office. This is stuff that you do all the time. You've probably stepped up your protocols a little bit right now, but it's helpful to show patients what you're doing behind the scenes to give them that sense of peace to know that things are being cleaned and things are organized in the back end. So let me show this.
Our sterilization room. After every appointment, when your instruments come back here, we take your dirty instruments and we put them in our ultrasonic bath here. And after they're in the ultrasonic bath, this gets turned on, they shake
it's
in
like
there.
It's a jacuzzi, yeah.
It's a jacuzzi. It shakes everything, it cleans all of the debris off of the instruments. We clean the trays down with the Cavi wipes, as well as we do the stations, like she told you. After these shake in the ultrasonic, then they get bagged up into sterilization pouches. And then the sterilization pouches go into our autoclave. And the autoclave cooks them and kills anything that, any bacteria that could be on them.
Oh, awesome.
And then once That's they great. Come out of the autoclave, they go into our, just all of our little bins.
Wow, you're so
and
organized.
And they stay in all of the sterilization pouches until we open them up at the station with you.
All right, so many people might not even know what an autoclave is, and this is an opportunity that you can explain what that is, that it kills all the bacteria and everything on those instruments. And again, that really helps give that peace of mind. Describe your new protocols for keeping patients and your team members safe. And I like this video that's done in Knoxville Smiles and Malone, because he just really shows that he's thought of everything. And you may not be doing all of the things that he explains in this video, and I'm just going to show a little portion of it, but it gives you the confidence that he's really been thinking about everything.
We've done some really cool stuff over the last month and a half, instead of just sitting home and watching Netflix, which we have done a certain amount, but we've incorporated the way patients are going to flow through this office. We've gone through protocols extending patient appointments so that we can have extended time cleaning the rooms. We've put up guards at the front desk so that our front desk staff feels safer. We've put HEPA filtration systems in around the office. We've ordered industrial hospital strength HEPA filters to be placed inside the office, and we're looking at creating a negative pressure environment through our ductwork so that the whole building is like a hospital.
All right. So you can really tell, again, he's thought of everything. He explains all of those things there. Here's another example. Davis and Enger Dentistry, they do such a great job at explaining to their patients things and posting on social media. And this is a video that she did. She went live, and she calls it Tooth Talk Tuesday. And she just went live on her Facebook page, which is a great idea, because then people can comment as you're live, and you can respond to questions as they're commenting and while you're live. But she does the same thing. Let me just show you a part of this video.
I wanted to come on today and start letting you know about what to expect when coming to the office. Our primary concern, as always, has been the safety of our patients and the safety of our team. So things might look a little bit different. So at Davis and Enger Dentistry, you'll notice that everyone on our team will be wearing a mask, and we're going to be asking all of our patients to wear masks as they come to their appointments as well. We're going to try and minimize any patient-to-patient interactions and respect social distancing. So what this means is that we're going to be spreading our appointments apart. So we're going to have less patients in the office at one time. We're also establishing a virtual waiting room, or curbside check-in, if you will. We're going to be asking that when you arrive, you call us and wait in your car so we can let you know when we're ready to seat you. But at Davis and Enger Dentistry, we're known for being on time, so I really don't expect that you'll have to wait for long, but this will just help minimize the number of patients that we have in our waiting room.
I love how sincere she is, and she's just acting like she's just talking directly to a patient. That's what you can do in these videos. If you're not comfortable doing videos like this, I would encourage you to start and to try doing this. Don't feel like you have to be perfect. It's okay if you mess up in the videos. But if you really don't feel comfortable doing videos, you can still just post photos like this. This is her again, Davis and Enger Dentistry, and she just shows this mask that she's going to be wearing. And I love some of these comments that are made on it. It says, "So glad you guys are taking precautions to keep yourselves and others safe. Stay well." And then another person that said, "Never doubted that you would make sure we will all be protected. Thank you for your excellent care." And so these type of comments from your patients just build that trust. Here's another example of practices showing their PPE. This is another little TikTok video I'm going to show of a practice, a fun way to show their people. All right, if you're familiar with TikTok, that's just a dance that a lot of people are doing right now, and they just decided to do it with their PPE. If you have new equipment that you're using, you can take photos of that, whether it's a HEPA filter or this oral vacuum. The thing's crazy looking. They said they call it an elephant nose. If you have things like that, just so that people, when they come to your practice, they're not caught off guard with what this big elephant nose is in their appointment, explain those things beforehand. And I think that will really help not catch people off guard. This is one video that I want to show that's a little bit different than the other ones that I've shown. And I'll explain to you why afterwards.
Hi, I'm Dr. David Bradley, coming to you from Lake Oconee Dentistry. I know a lot of you, but not quite all of you. So on behalf of all of our doctors and team, I just wanted to give you a quick update on where we are as far as opening the practice. Earlier this week, Governor Kemp gave permission for dental offices to resume operation again. But I want to fill you in a little bit on why we're just not quite ready for that yet. We think it's a little bit too early. So what's going on? Like every other business, healthcare-wise or other in the planet right now, we're all trying to make sure that when we can open, that your safety and the safety of our team is always the biggest priority. We want to make sure that we've got all of our T's crossed and I's dotted. So what we're working on, we've ordered a lot of protective equipment for our team. That protects our team, but it also protects you as well. A lot of that's on back order. We don't have it in our hands yet. By not having it in our hands, it's not safe to open. We've ordered other things for the facility. Just for our whole facility, we've ordered air scrubbers and sterilizers and things for the air that we all come in contact with. Those are not here and they're not installed yet. We also have lack of other protocols and things that are in place that, quite honestly, our profession hasn't even defined and passed down to us yet. So with certain things, we can't do them because we don't really know the safe way to do that procedure at this time. We're working on all of that stuff. So we want to thank those.
So this is interesting, right? Because this was actually a video that they shot. This was on April 24th, and they're actually opening now. But they weren't quite ready to open on April 24th. And even though the governor said that they could open, they weren't quite ready. So he just explains that to his patients. He's very transparent. He says, you know, a lot of the equipment is on back order. And he says, you know, once we get all this equipment and once we have everything in place, then once we know things are safe, then we'll reopen. So you might be in the situation right now where you're not quite ready. It's okay to make a video like this and inform your patients about just where you are currently. And if you're not quite ready to open, just be transparent. They find that on social media, people just like to be informed. They like to know what's happening. And this builds so much trust with your patients. They'll know that when you do open, that you'll make that you will be prepared. So it's okay to do it in that way as well. This is something that I saw online. I'm not promoting this brand or anything. I'm not endorsing this eAssist brand, but this was something interesting I saw. eAssist, they have this certification exam on their page, on their website, and it's a 36 question exam that you can go through, and it just asks you about all your safety protocols, and then when you're done, it creates this little certificate for you that you can post on your social media accounts that says that you passed the COVID-19 cleanliness certification test. Gives you a little certificate, and that gives you little badges that you can use on your social media accounts or in your email. So this type of trust that this a certification like this would build is really good for you to show your patients, and again, builds that trust. You might want to dedicate a post specifically to questions and concerns. You can do a little poll asking about the anxiety level of your patients, and if some patients respond that they're pretty anxious to come in your practice, you can create a direct one-to-one conversation with that person through Messenger. And then if you do start talking to patients on social media about your safety protocols, be available and respond promptly. This is actually a really cool feature of Facebook, where when people go to your Facebook page, you can actually preload some questions in the chat box at the bottom. If you're familiar with what a chat bot is, you can load some questions and then you can load the answers to those questions. So you can ask things like, what safety precautions are you taking during the COVID-19 pandemic? And then you can actually preload a video where you talk about those safety precautions. And when they ask that question, it can send them some text of what you're doing, and then it can also send a little video. So it's really easy to set this up. If you go to your inbox in Facebook and you go down to your automated responses, it gives you a few different options. You can create an instant reply. So if anybody asks you a question about anything, you can preload an answer into there. You can set an away message. So if you're not available, you know, if it's the middle of the night, you can send them a different type of message of how quickly you respond to their question. And then, like I mentioned, this is the frequently asked questions. You can load 5 questions in there. And then you can record a little video and you can, or put a photo in there and you can respond with that video or photo. So that's something cool you might want to try. And then if you have someone in charge of responding to messages on Facebook, just be sure they have the notifications turned on. If you go to your page settings, so that they get an email or a text message or a notification every time someone sends you a message, so you can respond really quickly. That's so important right now. Well, a lot of people are confused and have questions. The last thing I want to go over, I'm running out of time here, but I just want to talk about communicating scheduling, your scheduling plan to your patients. So this is just a quick video and I'm going to talk about it after.
Hey everybody. Got some great news. We are starting back up May 8th, and that's based off of Governor Cooper's announcement as of yesterday. So we are super excited. It's been too long. We're really anxious to get back, just like you guys are. For those of you that have appointments currently scheduled May 4th through May 7th, someone from our office is going to be reaching out to you in the near future, most likely through text message, to cancel those appointments. And then starting on May 8th, we're going to start seeing patients again. Now, we have to kind of prioritize how we're seeing patients because there are a lot of appointments to make up for. What we'll do is we're going to start by seeing emergencies, kind of first, and those of you that have been waiting the longest. So those of you that had appointments that were canceled dating back to the end of March will be the ones that will receive appointments first. And then we'll kind of work our way up to the most recent cancellations from there. We appreciate everybody's patience as we get all this kind of worked out. And Dr. Rankin is going to kind of go through with you guys some of the exciting changes here at the office.
Okay, so when you talk about scheduling, here's some things you want to cover. Make sure you tell them your reopening date. How soon will canceled appointments be rescheduled? If someone had a canceled appointment and they want to find out what's going on without calling you, let them know how soon they'll be rescheduled. How will they be contacted? Will you be texting them? Will you be sending them an email? Will you be calling them on the phone? What are your first priority appointments? So are you going to see the emergency patients first or the people that canceled? What if somebody just wants a teeth whitening? How long can they expect to wait before they get in? And then you always want to emphasize the urgency to schedule. I think you can do this in almost all your posts. Just make sure that people are contacting you to get on your book, on your schedule as soon as possible. A couple of quick tips on Facebook as well. There's something called pinning your posts. So if you any information that's updating people on the schedule, on the safety, these would be great posts to pin to your top of your to the top of your Facebook page. And what that is every post that you make, there's three little dots on the top right-hand corner. If you click on that, there's a drop-down and it will say pin to top of page. And what it will do is it'll keep that post at the top of your Facebook page for, I think it's 7 days. And so you can, as you come up with these type of videos or this type of information, just make sure you pin the most important information to the top of your page. And then email is still such a powerful tool. I know I'm talking a lot about social media, but a great way to work in email and social media is send these videos out in an email to your patients, like this one on the left, but link it directly to your Facebook post. And the great thing about that is that when people watch the video, they could then like it, they can share it, they can comment on it. So rather than just having them watch a video on YouTube where maybe nothing happens, at least it's going into a platform where they can still watch it and then they can interact with it as well. So use email and link it to your social media accounts. Again, if you want this worksheet that talking about all these phases and has all these ideas in it, go to info.mysocialpractice.com/worksheet. We want to help you at My Social Practice. We create strategies for dental practices, customized strategies to help them get through all of this right now and then into the future. We'll assign you a social media manager that will help you out. We'll give you a calendar of what to post and when to post things. We'll even send you a box full of props and signs and fun ideas that are relevant to that month, so you don't have to try to think of what to post. That's the hardest part for dental practices is figuring out what should I post today? And we take care of all of that for you. We also even do more than just social media. We can help you with your website. We can help you with SEO. We can help you get more Google reviews. We kind of help with your entire digital presence. And as far as websites go, we can help integrate some of the things Tom talked about as well, some digital forms onto your website. which can be a huge help. So this is the contact information for both Tom and myself and some links that we talked about. And I'll turn it back over to Natalie for some questions that we have.
Okay, great. Thank you, Dr. Cockrell, and thank you, Blake. Those were awesome presentations. A lot of great.
You're welcome.
A lot of great takeaways for our listeners. Okay, we do have a couple questions for you both just to wrap things up. And again, if anyone on the line has questions, please feel free to ask them in the chat or in the Q&A feature. And I'll read your questions to Dr. Cockrell and Blake here. Okay, so this one is for Blake. Which social media platform should I focus on?
So we have found for dental practices, the best platforms are Facebook. I've talked a lot about that. Instagram. Instagram's actually growing faster than Facebook. Facebook's still the leader, but Instagram is actually growing faster than Facebook. So it's important that you start creating your presence and building a following on Instagram right now. It's a super powerful tool for content creation. And then, of course, Google My Business is really important right now. It's not really considered a social platform, but they're building more into it to make it really powerful in that way. So make sure your Google My Business page is updated. And then, of course, your website, I think, is still a great, powerful branding tool. So if you can focus on those four platforms right now, I know I talked about TikTok and Twitter. I mean, I didn't talk about Twitter, but there's a lot of platforms. Just focus on those four for right now. That's what I'd say.
Okay, great. Okay, this one's for Dr. Cockrell. What system do you use for teledentistry?
Yes, that's a good question. There are numerous ones available, and it seems like every week I'm seeing a new offering for doing that. I use Doxy.me. There's a free version of it. It's good. I think I paid $30 a month for an upgraded version. I like it because I can snap photos of the patient while I'm talking to them, and then include those photos in my presentation back to them. So that's what I like. I don't really have any experience with any others, but it's getting to be a pretty common offering.
Awesome. Thank you. Okay, this one's for Blake. Should I be boosting my posts?
Yes, definitely. So if you're not familiar with what boosting is, Facebook has an option to boost the posts that you make, and that's just putting a little bit of money into it to make sure people see those posts. Facebook is really a pay-to-play model to some extent. If you really want people to see your content, you have to put a little bit of money into it. So we definitely recommend that you try putting maybe $5 into some of these important posts that you're doing. And if they start getting some engagement and people start liking it and commenting on it, you will know that this is good content. So maybe you might want to put a little bit more money into it. We can help you kind of set up those audiences and create those boosted posts or know how to do it. So, but we definitely recommend that, yes, you boost your posts.
Okay, great. And then here's another one for Dr. Cockrell. Can you create custom forms?
Yes. Unlimited custom forms. They're easy to create, or we'll help you with that. You know, okay. A practice has special interests. You know, they may want to, if they have a heavy emphasis on cosmetic dentistry, for example, they might want a form on their portal that asks questions specific for that. In my case, where I treat a lot of special needs adult patients, I have a couple of custom forms, for instance, about caregiver staff, responsibility, responsibility forms. So you can have as many as you want.
Okay, awesome. Okay, this one's for Blake. If I have a video, where should I put it first? Should I share a YouTube link?
This is a great question. And I actually see another one. May I address this one as well? It looks like it says, would you link Facebook and Instagram accounts so they post the same content? Sometimes people ask this question because they don't know where you should put your content first. You know, should you put it on YouTube first and then share a link on your Facebook page, or should you put it on Instagram first and then have it posted to Facebook? I guess the overall question is, put your content everywhere. The more places you can put your content, the better. And it doesn't matter. You might think, oh, I don't want someone to see it on Instagram and someone to see it on Facebook. For the most part, people don't care that they see it in two places, and you'll reach more people in that way. So yes, I would definitely link your Facebook and Instagram so you're posting same content on both pages. And then if you want to upload it to YouTube, upload it to YouTube, upload it to Facebook, upload it to Instagram, upload it everywhere. And these platforms like it when you upload content natively to their site. It actually helps a lot more. If you upload a video directly to Facebook, Facebook will likes that and they will show that video to more people. So don't worry about posting too much. For the most part, just put the same content everywhere. I will say one thing about Instagram. The Instagram stories, if you're familiar with that, is a really powerful content creation tool that allows you to create more just on the spot, quick type of videos. And I think that content is a little bit different for what you might make for a post, but that content is really great right now. It's really sincere. People like that type of content. So I would try that out on Instagram.
Okay, awesome. And then Dr. Cocker, we just have someone that wants to clarify, what was the teledentistry platform that you used?
Yes, I actually didn't show the actual teledentistry platform, but to describe that is you just go to Doxy. What I use is doxy.me, and that opens up a window, your window, your dashboard, and it will show people in your waiting room. You click on the waiting room, the patient's name, and their image comes up, and they see you. I didn't show that just in the interest of time. What I did show was in our solution, the way to for the patient to request the online consultation and then how to send a report back to that. So that's within the Dental Symphony application itself. I hope that answers, Natalie. I hope that answers the question.
Yeah, of course. And obviously for everyone here, if you have further questions or clarification, you can always reach out to Tom or Blake. Their info is right here on the screen. So if you have any further questions, you can do that. I think we just have one more for Blake. Which social media platforms should I focus on?
I think I might have addressed that one. That one's
Oh, you did. Okay, great.
The Facebook, yeah, Instagram. And,
okay, yes. The last question is, what is a good mobile app to use to edit videos?
Oh, yeah, I have a great question. I think, so TikTok's actually, they've built in a lot of things into TikTok to let you edit videos. I show some of those examples. Instagram Stories lets you edit videos and add little captions onto the top of the video and put stickers and GIFs. And then you can just, if you don't want to post it on Instagram, you can just download it and share it on Facebook or wherever you like. Natalie, you might know a couple different apps that you use. Natalie does a lot of the posts on My Social Practices Facebook page. Is there anything that you, any apps that you like to use?
Yeah, actually, I use one called, it's called Mojo, M-O-J-O. That's really fun. They have a lot of different things on there. And then there's another one I like that's called Video Collage. And then Scene. S-E-E-N. So those are kind of my top ones. There's lots of, I mean, I think you could probably Google it depending on what you're looking for too. If you want to do different types of edits, there's a lot of options, but those are my top ones.
Cool.
I think that one. Oh, go ahead.
Now, I do see one question. Maybe Tom can just address this real quick. Someone was just asking about, you know, a lot of practices are starting to maybe charge an additional fee because of PPE that you're using, you know, extended PPE that you're using. They're just asking, if so, how did you inform your patient? Well, first, did you end up doing that in your practice? And then if so, how did you inform your patients? And was there any negative feedback on that?
Yes, good question. I don't at the moment do that. I'm thinking about it. As I mentioned earlier about, you know, talk to your colleagues and friends about this. I hear about some dentists are charging for each patient every time. I understand that there are a couple of insurance companies that are paying for that and some that aren't. For me, it's a little too early to decide because we're still, even 3 weeks into it, we're still coming to grips with exactly how much we need and what are we able to reuse and how long the mask will last. I will say personally, though, that I think it's a justified fee. I mean, we are having to get a whole nother trash container because we have so much more trash we're getting rid of every week, every day, every week. And so, I mean, we're spending a lot of time ordering, storing, bringing out, getting rid of, taking the time to put it on. There ought to be a fee for that. I'm not an expert knowing how much or how to bill for that, but I certainly would support that.
Great. I think a video again, like Tom made the video, just explaining why. I mean, of course, if you end up doing that, you'll probably get some negative feedback, but I think if you can explain in a video, that'd be really helpful as well.
Mm-hmm. I think we have one more question for Blake. What app can you use to manage all Instagram and Facebook personal and business?
Oh, great question. There's a lot of apps out there that do help. You know, Hootsuite is one that's really popular. I guess I'll make a plug for my social practice. We have an app that allows you to put on your phone and on your desktop where you can post to your business accounts. It doesn't bring in your personal page, but to your business accounts, it makes it really easy to get content and post it everywhere. Another one is if you go to, Natalie, is it Facebook Creators Studio? Is that what it's called?
Yeah.
Yeah, so if you search Facebook Creators Studio and just search that on Google, a lot of people don't know about this, but Facebook's built a desktop app where you can post to Instagram and Facebook. I don't know if it brings in your personal account. Does it, Natalie? Do you know if you can post to personal?
I think it might just be for business.
Okay. But it does bring in, you know, your messages. It allows you to post from that platform. So you might want to check that one out too.
Awesome. Okay. I think let's just make sure I'm not missing anybody. Someone's asking Dr. Cockrell, can we have access to the patient forms you showed?
I'm sorry, Natalie, is there access? Do they have access to the forms?
Yeah, they said, can we have access to the patient forms you showed?
Sure. We're happy to demonstrate the application to you and let you see them. I mean, it's not like they're... I may be misunderstanding that question. They, by default, all of these forms that I showed you come with the product.
Okay, great. And again, their information is here on the screen. So if you'd like to ask any further questions about Dental Symphony or my social practice, you can contact them from the information here or visit dentalsymphony.com or mysocialpractice.com to request a demo and see how these two companies can help you and your practice post-pandemic or with forms, whatever you guys need. So I think that wraps up our questions. Thank you for joining us. Thank you to Blake and Dr. Cockrell. We hope that everyone has a great weekend and Friday.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
All right.